Turn back to Romans 15. We will be having preacher's class this Saturday at 10 o'clock. Romans 15. And I want us to notice Paul's use of the personal pronoun, my. Now to him that's of power to establish you according to my gospel. Now here's what I want us to deal with. When can I say that the gospel is my gospel? When can I use the personal pronoun my with regard to the gospel of Jesus Christ? Now, Paul said earlier in Romans chapter 2, verse 16, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. Now, ordinarily, when somebody would say, this is my gospel, I would think, I don't care what your gospel is. I want to know what the gospel is. Well, we got to begin there, don't we? What is the gospel? Now, the gospel is an objective message with a definite content. It is what it is, whether I believe it or not, whether you believe it or not. It is what it is, whether I'm saved by it or whether I'm not saved by it. The gospel is what it is, and it's not subject to man's thoughts, definitions, ideas, or opinions. I like saying that. I love what Paul said in Galatians chapter 1. I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me was not after man. It was not derived from any human source. He said, I neither received it from man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, the gospel is the gospel with a definite content. Now, when can I call the gospel my gospel? Now, that's something we all ought to be very interested in. I want to be able to call the gospel of God, the gospel of Christ, the gospel concerning His Son, the gospel of grace, I want it to be able to call it my gospel. Turn with me for a moment to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Verse 1, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. I love that definite article. The gospel that excludes anything that's not just like it. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you. It's the same gospel that I first preached to you, and it hadn't changed any at all. It's the same gospel, which also you have received. It's the gospel that you found to be good news. And wherein you stand, it's the gospel that you stand in. You can stand before God and not be driven away in the gospel. By which also you're saved. This is the saving gospel. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain, it's the gospel you must persevere in. You can't forget it. And here it is, for I delivered unto you first of all, of first importance, that which I also received, and I love this. Paul said, I'm simply delivering to you what I received. The gospel, this is not my take on the gospel. This is not my thoughts on the gospel. This is what God gave to me. This is the gospel. It's how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. That's what I delivered first. I don't know how many times I've heard preachers say the gospel is the life, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. No, it's not. It's how that. How that. Christ died for our sins according to the Old Testament scriptures. You can't preach the gospel and not preach the Old Testament scriptures. It's how that. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. It's a definite message that excludes anything that's contrary to it. Turn to Galatians 1, verse 6. I marvel, Paul says, that you're so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. There are not two gospels. There's not a different version of the gospel. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert, would change the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we've preached unto you, let him be accursed. And just in case somebody didn't hear me, as we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which you've received, let him be accursed. Let him be damned is what that means. Let him be sent to hell. Now, let me ask you a question. Is Paul being harsh? Is Paul being too narrow? No, Paul's doing the only thing of love that there is, to preach the gospel and not give in to anything else. Peter spoke in Acts chapter 15, verse 7, of the word of the gospel. And I like thinking about this. There are certain words that are used. Words like election, justification, predestination, redemption, being born again, sanctification, being preserved. There's all kinds of words that are used. And any time a man willingly omits any of those words, you no longer have the gospel. The gospel, the gospel, is made of many truths which make the gospel. And if you leave out one of those truths willingly, you fail to preach the gospel. Now, the gospel is also called the gospel of God. I like that name for the gospel, don't you? The gospel of God. The gospel of which he is the author, of which he is the subject, and of which he is the end. Paul said, but of him, and through him, and to him are all things. To whom be glory both now and forever. He calls this gospel in 1 Timothy 1:11 the glorious gospel of the blessed God. Or it could more accurately be translated the gospel of the glory of the blessed God. Now in the gospel, who gets the glory? Now we know from the scripture that we're saved to the praise of the glory of his grace. I see it. And I know that that means, he said, my glory I'll not share with another. But I know this not only from the scripture, but on a personal level, I can say with such depth of conviction that if I am saved, if I end up among the redeemed, he's going to get all the glory. None will go to me. I can say that with such depth of conviction. This is for his glory. And it's called the gospel of Christ. It's the gospel. It's the gospel of God. It's the gospel of Christ. The gospel of God concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Mark calls it the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Christ himself is the gospel. You believe that? Jesus Christ himself is the gospel. The gospel is a person. Jesus Christ of the seed of David, made of the seed of David according to the flesh and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness and the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The gospel is called many times the gospel of the kingdom. I like that name for the gospel of the kingdom. You know, the kingdom is about the king. And it's about his subjects too. You know, all of his subjects love him being king. Do you love Jesus Christ being King of Kings and Lord of Lords? All of his subjects do. They all love him being king. They need him to be king. And I love that scripture, Revelation 17, 14. He's the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and all they that are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. It's the gospel of the kingdom. Speaking of the King of Kings and his jurisdiction. It's called in Acts chapter 20, 24, the gospel of the grace of God. What a name for the gospel. The gospel of the grace of God. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 6. Now this is the way the world reads this verse of Scripture. Verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually, except for one man, Noah. He wasn't like that. Noah was a just man and righteous before God. Now, is Noah included in Genesis chapter 6, verse 5? Absolutely. Now here's what the gospel of grace does. Let's go on reading. Verse 8. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God. Chapter 7, verse 1. And the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Now this is what the grace of God does. It takes somebody like Noah, and somebody like me, and somebody like you, and makes me perfect and righteous and undefiled before God. Really? Really? I really am righteous and holy and undefiled before God. And when I say that to you, I'm thinking, what about all the sins you commit? You think the same thing. Could that be so? Yes, it is so, because this is in God's sight. And this is what the grace of God does. It takes a sinner and makes him perfect in God's sight. You see, Noah was the recipient of electing grace. God chose him before time began. He was the recipient of justifying grace. God justified him. God redeemed him. He was in the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. He called him by his grace. He gave him a new nature. He walked with God. And this is because of the gospel of the grace of God. In Galatians chapter 2:14, we read of the truth of the gospel. Now, I love this passage of Scripture. I think this is one of the most poignant declarations of what the gospel is. It's where Peter was eating supper with the Gentiles, having a good time fellowshipping in the gospel. And certain from James came, the church of Jerusalem. And the Scripture says, Peter feared them that were of the circumcision. They're going to look down on me for eating with the Gentiles. So Peter, without saying a word, rose up from the table of the Gentiles and walked over and sat down with the Jews. He didn't say anything, but you know what Paul said he did? He denied the truth of the gospel. And Paul publicly rebuked him for that. Now, what is the truth of the gospel? What is it that Peter denied that Paul felt a need to publicly rebuke him for? Because, I mean, that's a big deal to get publicly rebuked in front of. Don't anybody publicly rebuke me unless I really need it. I don't want to do it to you either. I don't want to get humiliated in front of people and embarrassed. Can you imagine how embarrassed Peter was when Paul did this? But Paul had a need to do it. What was it Peter was saying? He was saying, if I leave the Gentile tables and get up and sit over here with the Jews, I'll be a little bit more pleasing to God. All that is a denial that Jesus Christ is all in salvation. That's all that is. And Paul said he had to rebuke Peter that the truth of the gospel might remain. He was in danger of leaving if Paul didn't deal with that. What is the truth of the gospel? That Jesus Christ is all in salvation. Oh, how I love that. Everything God requires of me, he looks to Christ for. There's nothing I can do to make myself more pleasing to God. I'm altogether pleasing to God through Christ. My position can't get any better. I can't get any more accepted. I can't get any more loved. Don't you love the truth of the gospel? That's the truth of the gospel. And then we read in Ephesians 6, verse 19, of the mysteries of the gospel. I love this. The gospel's a mystery. It's something we would have never known had not God been pleased to make it known. Do you think you could come up with the formula of the Trinity? Well, I believe God is one God in three distinct persons. You'd never know anything like that. You'd never know how God could be just and justify the ungodly. You'd never know anything about the great mystery of union with Christ. I speak a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. The two shall be made one flesh. I'm one with Christ. The great mystery of Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, these are mysteries that we would have never known had God not made them known. And we could read them all day long without even thinking about them or knowing what they mean unless God was pleased to reveal them. Unto you it's given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Oh, how we love the mysteries of the Scripture. And you know, what I love about the mysteries of Scripture, I just believe them. I don't so much intellectually comprehend them. I believe them, though. And everything God... You know, regarding, say, creation, you don't have to have revelation for that. You can know with common sense that God created the universe. It just makes sense. Something couldn't just take place. Something couldn't just be. All of a sudden there's life. Somebody had to cause this. Somebody made this, and nobody made him. You can know that intellectually. You don't have to have revelation to know that. But you have to have revelation to know God forgives sin for Christ's sake. You have to have revelation to know that God is holy. You have to have revelation to know that you can only be justified by what Christ did. Now, we love the mysteries of the gospel. And then we read in Philippians 4:15, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5, of the gospel of peace. The gospel of peace. I'm sorry, Ephesians 6:15. The gospel of peace. Now, what that is the peace. When we talk about the gospel, we're talking about the peace that Christ made for me. Having made peace, Colossians 1:20, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Now, is it any wonder that the angels broke out in that choir, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. You see, Christ is my peace with God. I can't tell you what kind of peace I experience when I'm made to see that I'm justified by what Christ did. And that God doesn't have any reason to be mad at me. that God doesn't have any reason to be displeased with me, that I'm perfect in Christ Jesus. And I can't express to you the peace I feel from that. Now, if you tell me there's something I need to do, all my peace leaves. I don't have any peace. But if you tell me that Christ did it all, Jesus paid it all the debt I owe, sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow, what peace I experience. Truly, it's the gospel of peace. It's how He made my peace. And the peace we experience is this. He was delivered for our offenses. He was raised again for our justification. Therefore, being justified. I'm not justified by an act of my faith. I'm justified because He was delivered for my offenses and raised again for my justification. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, my subjective experience of peace is believing that He made all my peace and that all God requires of me, He looks to His Son for. Do you believe that? If you believe that, you know what you're going to experience? Peace. The joy and the peace of believing. And then in Colossians 1:23, we read of the hope of the gospel. Now, let me remind you about this thing of hope. Hope's something you can't see. If you can see it, it ain't hope. Isn't that what Paul said? What a man seeth, why does he yet hope for it? But if we hope for that which we see not, then we with patience wait for it. Romans 8:24-25. Now, I've got a hope that I can't see. First of all, I've got a hope that I am sinless before God. And when I say that, I'm laughing at myself while I say it, because while I can't see it, I can't see justification. I can't see perfect righteousness. I don't see it. Somebody says, do you really believe you're that way? Well, not by what I see. But I believe. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. I have a hope that when I stand before God in judgment, I'm going to be accepted, that He's going to say to me, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And I can't see any reason why He'd say that to me in myself. You know, I don't know how many times I've said that, and people say, you ought not say that. I've had people here, you know, say that you, do you really believe you're going to hear that? Yeah, I do. And it's because everything that God requires of me, He looks to Christ for. That's the reason. That's the only reason. What a hope there is that when He said it is finished, my salvation was finished. The hope of the gospel. I have the hope of Romans 8:28, that everything is working together. It's not working separately. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that happens. This is awful. I can't believe this. I can't believe this has happened to me, or I can't believe this has happened to them, or this is terrible. What good can come out of this? All these things separately work together. Work together for good. To them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. What hope there is in the gospel. And I love 2 Thessalonians 2:14, where He called you by our gospel. The gospel is the calling gospel. The calling gospel. The gospel is a call. It's a call to believe. It's a call to repent. It's not just giving people information. We're called upon to respond to the gospel, to believe, to repent, to bow the knee to Christ. It's the calling of, we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews a stumbling block, unto the Greeks foolishness, but unto them which are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God, Christ the wisdom of God. I'm called upon to repent of anything that's contrary to the gospel. I repent of believing in salvation by works in any way. I believe the gospel. And you know something the called do? They call. Anybody that's been called by God, you know what they're going to do? They're going to call on the name of the Lord. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we read in Philemon or Philippians 4:15, of the beginning of the gospel. The beginning of the gospel. Now this is talking about the beginning of the gospel in our experience, because the gospel had no beginning. It's called in Revelation 14:6, I think. Yeah, Revelation 14:6, the everlasting gospel. The gospel never had a beginning. It never had a point in which it began to be. It's as old as God, and it'll never have an ending. The gospel, like its author, is eternal and immutable. It's the everlasting gospel. But in my experience, there is a beginning. There was a time when I was not saved. And there's a time when I was. There's a time when I didn't know God. And there was a time when I came to know Him. Now, there was a time when I would have been described as children of wrath, just like everybody else. No different than any unbeliever, no different than any heathen, no different than anybody that didn't know God. I was described as a child of wrath, wrathful children, even just like everybody else. But then there was a time when I believed the gospel. I think of that passage of Scripture in Romans chapter 10. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be what? Saved. Two things Paul says about these people. I want them to be saved. That's my heart's desire. They're not saved. Now he says in the next verse, I bear them record, they have a zeal for God. They're very religious. Even the God of the Bible. They have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness. Now, somebody that's ignorant of God's righteousness is somebody who thinks somehow they can please God by some act of their own righteousness. Anybody that believes anything like that is completely ignorant of God's righteousness. If I have any understanding of God's righteousness, I'm going to know something about my complete unrighteousness. They, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, here's what they haven't done. They haven't submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. They haven't agreed with God when God says, you deserve to be damned. They'd say, no, I don't. No, I don't. They've not submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ God has saved you. You get a cold. You get diseases. You get awards. But you don't get salvation. You find out God has saved you. And you know what else? You find out when it happened. I can tell you when I was saved. I was saved before time began. He saved us and He called us with a holy calling. Not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. You find out when you were saved. I was saved when He said, it is finished. And I was saved when I heard and when I believed the gospel, and not before then. There's no salvation apart from hearing and believing the gospel. The gospel of your salvation. And then Paul said in 2 Timothy 1:8, "Be not ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel." The afflictions of the gospel. If you preach the gospel to somebody that doesn't believe, they're not going to like you for it. And that's what the Lord was talking about when he said, you're to deny yourself. You're to take up your cross. That's the afflictions of the gospel. The natural man hates the gospel. Now, I've said this several times in the last couple of weeks. He doesn't hate a Jesus that is a doormat that wants to save you, but he can't unless you let him. Nobody hates that Jesus because he's not fearful. But the Jesus that salvation's in his hand, and it's up to him as to whether or not you'll be saved. No, it's not up to you. It's up to him. It's up to him. You don't have any control in this. That Jesus men nailed to a cross. They didn't like that Jesus, and they don't now. And may God give me grace to be willing to bear the afflictions of the gospel. Okay, I've said all those things to say this. I've talked about these definitions of the gospel. I've given everything in the scripture that goes with the gospel. Now, when is the gospel my personal gospel? Well, first of all, the gospel is gospel to me when I see the gospel that excludes all other gospels. And I'm glad it's that way because I don't have two things to make me confused by. There's only one gospel. And it's the gospel that excludes all other gospels. And that's good news to me. When it's good news to me that the gospel is the gospel of God, it's not man's invention. Oh, how I love this. This is the gospel of God. This is not the gospel of Todd or the gospel according to the Baptists or the gospel according to the Presbyterians or Catholics. This is the gospel of God. And this is the gospel of Christ. It's gospel to you when you delight that it's the gospel of Christ. It's concerning Him. It's concerning His glory. It's concerning His sufficiency. That's good news to you. And you love the gospel of the kingdom because you love the King of the kingdom. You love Him being King. Are you glad that Jesus Christ is sovereign? That He controls everything and everybody? And He's truly got the whole world in His hand, and He's doing whatsoever He's pleased to do. Where's your God, David? He's in the heavens. He's done whatsoever He pleased. Oh, I love the Christ who's the absolute King and Monarch of the universe. And the gospel is your gospel. It's my gospel when grace becomes good news. You know, it's good news to me that God elected a people. It's good news to me that Jesus Christ died for the elect and accomplished their salvation. It's good news to me that God's grace is invincible and irresistible. That's good news. That's the only kind of grace that'll save me. That's what saving grace is. The gospel becomes your gospel when it's good news to you that salvation is of the Lord. That He does it all because you know you can't bring anything to the table. It becomes good news. The gospel of the grace of God. And then the truth of the gospel that Christ is all. Does that make you happy? Is that good news to you that Christ is all? That everything that God requires of you is in Christ. That no works for you to do. You're complete in Him. You're accepted in the Beloved. What good news. It's good news. It's your gospel when you believe the mysteries.
of the gospel. You just believe them. You know, I do. I was telling somebody, Claire, I think I was telling you this morning, the message of everything being understood only by the cross. I really believe that. I really believe that. I don't believe it simply because somebody taught it to me. I see it. Christ is all. That's the good news. That's the mystery revealed, the mystery of union with Christ. I love that, to think that God has never seen me independently of Christ, that I'm one with Him. What good news. What a gospel. And then the gospel of peace. I find peace only from the gospel. The gospel of hope. What hope I have in the gospel. The calling gospel. The gospel's called me to believe. It's commanded me to believe. It's commanded me to repent. Now, you know God's called you when you believe. Somebody says, I don't believe. Well, God never called you. If He calls you, you'll believe the gospel. You'll bow the knee to Christ. And in the beginning of this eternal gospel, I understand that I was saved before time began, and I love that. And that's my gospel. My gospel is that I was saved when Christ said it is finished. My gospel is that I was saved. I found out I was saved when I found out Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. And by His grace, I would find it the greatest honor I could ever have to have the afflictions of the gospel. Now, I know that apart from His grace, whenever I'm called upon to confess Christ, when it's going to cost me something, I know I'll chicken out. If it's going to cost me something. I know apart from God's grace, I'll chicken out. You know that too, don't you? You know that too. But I also know this. By His grace, the greatest privilege I could have is to die for His namesake. You would count that a privilege. You know the only way you'll do it is by the grace of God. But you, if you're a believer, you want to take up your cross. Deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that is when the gospel becomes my gospel. Now, when I'm saying my gospel, I'm not talking about my take on the gospel. I'm talking about when the gospel becomes my gospel. Let's pray. Lord, I ask in the high and holy name of Thy blessed Son that every one of us, by Your grace, might be enabled to say of the gospel of God, the gospel of Christ, that we might be enabled to say, that's my gospel. Lord, what a blessing of grace that we can say that this is indeed our gospel. We thank You for the gospel of Your Son. We thank You for the forgiveness of sins and the acceptance we have in Him. And Lord, we ask for grace to glorify Your gospel in our words, in our attitude, and in our conduct. Now bless this message for Christ's sake. In His name we pray. Amen.